Welcome back. We're in a video series of five steps, a pre-campaign checklist, help pastors launch a capital campaign for their church. How are you doing with your checklist so far? Good news is you can take any of these steps right now today, begin working toward a campaign launch at your church right now. In this video, we're going to be talking about step four, count the cost. There are a lot of pieces to this puzzle, but let's buckle up and let's jump right in. Hey, what's up? This is David Cassie, and on this channel, we're all about helping you share your vision and to raise maximum funds for your projects. In step three, we adopted a God-sized vision. Now, in step four, we're going to count the cost about what it's going to take to put this big ministry plan into place for your church. So the number one questions a lot of pastors ask is, how much money do you think we can raise when they start thinking about their capital campaign? You know, that's a good question to ask. But we've got to be realistic when we start dealing with the raw numbers. There's no perfect formula for raising funds, but one thing is for sure. The more you know about the numbers and the little details of your projects, the more capable your team is going to be in assessing the potential to get where you want to go to raise money for your church. Now, first of all, you're going to have to get your financial person involved in this process. You're probably going to need to spend quite a bit of time sitting around a conference room table, or maybe around their desk, running some numbers, talking about all the different facets of giving that's happening in your church already, like the ability for them to give, their capability of giving so far by the numbers that are coming into your church. And also, what is the ability to go beyond just the stewardship level and go to a place of generosity in giving as well? So another thing is, I just want you to not forget, there's what I call the God factor. And yes, we want to do our due diligence. We want to count the costs. And there's a lot of things that go into all that. Also, the spiritual side of it, obviously, is that there's always a God factor involved in these things. I've been working on capital campaigns for the last 25 years. And it just never ceases to amaze me that when God's people step out and they stretch their faith and they ask God to come in and do something special, something spectacular in the life of their church, things are going to happen. Things are going to happen that we could not foresee, that we're not going to know how it's going to go down. We all want to try to drive that sometimes. At the end of the day, what is really cool is to always see that God works the way he wants to work. And that is a big encouragement to the people. And it's a way that people look at it and go, man, that had to be God doing that. And I think that's exactly what he wants to do. He wants to show himself big. He wants you to make room for him to be big in the moment with you. Always count that as part of the process and engage on that level and be in an expectation of what God can do. Next, we're going to talk about the due diligence part of this process. So first of all, I want you to know that I'm not going to be able to give you an exact formula to give you the exact number that you're going to be able to raise. So to be brief, I'm going to give you some scenarios. If you haven't downloaded our PDF file, go to the link in the description, click on that, download it now, because there's going to be some things in there you're going to want to make a part of your process as you're walking through these five steps. Most consultants are going to tell you that you're going to be able to raise between 1.5 and 2.5 times your yearly church income. Now, this is based on a two-year campaign where you're going to be asking people to go above and beyond their tithe and offering and give in generously also toward a campaign initiative. Some churches opt for a three-year capital campaign. Give 3 years for the giving and end of year cycles to happen, the cash pledges to come in to take care of the initiative. Now, once you've figured out the predictive fundraising amount that you can raise, we want to talk about and look at the costs that are going to be involved in the other things that you're going to want to accomplish in your campaign. There will be ministry costs, building costs. You're going to be talking to professionals such as architects, construction people, consultants, city leaders. There are going to be fees and all kinds of things like that. So there's going to be a process and cost associated with all those things that you're going to be engaging with and pulling all together as part of your plan to move forward. Once you pull together the costs of everything and you look at what you can raise, you're going to have to decide, are you going to have to make up a difference? Okay. So then you're either going to decide, are you going to pull money from savings? Are you going to finance any debt between the two numbers? Or are you going to opt to make a decision to only build out in phases as the money comes in on the projects that you want to achieve. Now, there is one more thing I want to talk about. There are some times that you will actually save money by moving forward in your ministry plans. So maybe you have old buildings that just upkeep is too much, or you're doing ministry projects that, honestly, with new technology or something like that, you're going to be able to be much more productive and reach more people with less resources. If you're building new buildings, you may decide and think about the process that you're going to have more funds necessary for operating costs to run those buildings. So facilities costs, new ministry fees, maybe new employees, or whatever you're going to need to move those initiatives forward, you're either going to be less costs or more costs associated. Next up, I want you to understand the process, the capability of the church versus the tendency of the giving in the church. It may be one thing to run these formulas and say, hey, the capability of our church to give is X amount. We might be able to raise 2 times our church income over the next 2 years, and that's what it is. But actually, you need to consider also the tendency of what people are going to be giving in the process. This is going to be involving several factors, okay? So it's going to be involving their engagement in the process. Are they engaged? Are they emotionally bought into the project or the ministry initiatives that you're going to accomplish? All these things add up to, how's it going to affect them on a personal level? And that's going to affect different people in different ways. So we want to make sure that we're reaching out with our initiatives in ways that we're going to be able to touch a cross-section of different people. Everybody can feel the same engagement, emotional response to, yes, I want to see this happen. It's not just my church's vision or my pastor's vision, my vision too, and I'm going to grab a hold of it and be a part of it. That's a big part of going from just a capability of giving to understand the tendency, what they will give. If we can increase the engagement and get the buy-in and emotional attachment to the projects, can get that up, then we can also increase the percentage possibilities of people giving the full amount of their pledge or maybe even exceeding it. Next up, I want to talk about project costs and when it comes to the dreaming part of it, and then also the more detailed left brain architectural, you know, the design, all the specifics and things like that. And those start coming together. You know, I want you to take full responsibility for the church's ability to raise the funds necessary to build the vision that you're putting together. Now, I've seen it happen over and over, and no fault to architects per se, but a lot of architects, you know, they love doing what they do. And so if your dreaming is huge off the chart, they're loving that too, because it allows them to scratch that itch of things that they do. And they may not be as concerned or considering all the aspects and the fallout for what it means to do a high design, when in fact you may be on a little bit different budget and you may not be able to afford the dream level of everything you're talking about. Don't get totally caught up in the dream to run it through the process to go, is this attainable? Can we service debt and do all these different things that we're talking about? So have a good time dreaming, translate to the architects, talk about costs, fees, design, all those kinds of things to make sure that you're going down a track that you're going to be able to maintain and you're going to be able to accomplish the goals you've set out to do. So again, take responsibility for your ability to pay for it, but also be an expectation that God knows your dreams, He knows your heart, and He knows the ministry goals you've set forth and how you want to move forward in ministering to people. What can you afford with your current budget and debt load? And then to add the additional facility expenses. Number 2, should I and can I afford to borrow the difference in what is raised, pledged, and also received, and what is needed to build the vision? Can you afford to borrow the difference between what you receive and what is going to cost to build? Number 3, can you service the debt and operational costs once it's built? Cannot forget about, okay, once we get into the building, got to move forward. So you may have a lot more expenses, more employees, more cleaning, all kinds of things need to be happening, right? So count the cost of all that. There's going to be people involved. You're going to be, again, you're going to be tapping professional experts such as bankers, construction companies, architects, campaign coach, and creating viable solutions to accomplish your ministry plan. So be reasonable and lean into these people, right? Pray, increase your faith, reach out in a way to other people to grow in this process with you, and ask God to use this process to bring his people together, solidify and unify toward the goal of reaching the ministry objectives. There you go. Now, the last step is step number 5, which is your campaign design. We're going to talk about your calendar, what is the best time of year to roll this out by looking at all the dates. And you're also going to look at your campaign pre-planning. When is it time to really get your launch date in place and move toward that? Let's take it all the way home. We're on the final video, so click and tap on the screen now to watch the next video. And if you got value from this content, hit like and subscribe if you'd like to see more. Look forward to seeing you in the next video.